So very good evening, everyone, and welcome to all the faculties and all others on behalf of IAP Trivandrum. And today is our most awaited topic, that is pediatric trauma, which is very dreadful on thinking itself to all of us, because it involves so many social, medical, legal, all issues, and we are all little frightened to deal with pediatric trauma and emergency medicine. So today we will think, all the three expert doctors will enlighten us with the informations that we need in our practice. So we have three speakers today. The first talk is on an overview and introduction to the module by Dr. Vishnu Mohan, Chairperson PAP, Pediatric Trauma Management Consultant, Department of Pediatrics and Neonatology, Aster MIMS, Calicut. And that will be followed by a talk on structured approach to pediatric trauma, airway and breathing by our own Dr. Pramila Joji, who is the consultant in PICU and emergency medicine and medical superintendent of King's Health Trivandrum. And the next is talk will be on shock and head injury by Dr. Vivian Abraham, consultant pediatrician and intensivist of Lissy Hospital, Kochi. So,
thank you, Gladi Madam. Before going to the program, I invite T.P. Jayaraman sir, President IAP Kerala, for his presidential address.
Respected Dr. Santosh, Dr. Praveen, Dr. Vishnu, Dr. Riyas, and all other dignitaries on the platform. Actually, I am very happy to be with you for this module on trauma, because this was the first action plan which we planned when I took over as president-elect in 2020. From the first program which I designed was Dr. Vishnu had called me that day itself and asked me that we should have a module on the trauma. And for this module, I am really thankful to Dr. Vishnu for the idea as well as for the implementation. So this is one of the first modules, because no IAP has never done such a module on such an important topic, being the most common cause of mortality and morbidity among children. And this is one area where a timely action can prevent morbidity and mortality. And the most important part is that you should have a structured protocol how to deal with these children. And that is the reason why I attempted to have a module on pediatric trauma as presidential action plan of the year. And I'm thankful to Dr. Venu and Dr. Satish of MIMS and all the other Dr. Vivian Abraham and all the others who have contributed to the module and for the meticulous way they have prepared. Actually, we were planning some workshops also, physical workshops also along with this module. And due to COVID situation, we had to restrict to this Zoom platform training only. And I hope our action plan coordinator and president-elect Dr. Vijay Kumar will take this forward to the next year so that we will complete the module as we had envisaged when we started planning it. With these few words, I congratulate IAP Trivandrum and all others behind this program, and also I'm thankful to IAP Trivandrum for giving a stage for the presentation of this very important module. Thank you so much and best wishes for the program.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. Now I invite Dr. Johnny Sebastian, Secretary IAP Kerala, for his felicitation.
Good evening, all. Respected Chair, Santosh Kumar, sir, Secretary Dr. Praveen, National EB Board Member, Dr. Riyas, IAP Kerala President and my leader, Jayaraman sir, Dr. Pramila Madam, convener of this presidential action plan, Dr. Vishnu, other seniors and dear colleagues. I congratulate IAP Trivandrum and the Presidential Action Plan Committee for taking up this all important action plan in such a big way. I think we have already conducted several programs at different branches. And just because of this pandemic, we are not able to conduct hands-on workshops as it was designed by Dr. Vishnu Mohan. But we will surely do it as soon as the pandemic constraints are over. And we, as we all know, an estimated amount of around 1 million children have traumatic injuries every year. And many children who survive this trauma develop temporary or as well as permanent disabilities. So it accounts for around 12% of the total disease burden in children. And the most commonest causes, like fall from height and road traffic accidents, are the most commonest causes of pediatric trauma. And today we have three excellent speakers to enlighten us more on this topic. And I wish this webinar all success. Thank you, Jai Hind, JIAP. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I invite Dr. Riyas, National Executive Board Member, IAP, for his felicitation.
Thank you, Dr. Praveen. Respected President of IAP, Jayaraman, sir, Dr. Johnny, Dr. Vishnu, Pramila, Vivin, my dear friends. This is a very important program, like something which was needed for a long time, because we know that when children are brought with a serious trauma, we are the first interface. Always a pediatrician in the emergency or in the casualty will be seeing the child. And pediatric surgery, as we know, is a super specialty department. So there won't be anyone to receive children there, unlike adults, because adults, when they have a trauma, the first response happens with a specialist in that area. But here it is mainly by us only, pediatrician. So it is a need that we all get an idea of how to approach a child, and we should not cause any secondary injury. That is very, very important. And also we have to find out the tricky situations, like something which we need to intervene then and there, like a pneumothorax, a cardiac tamponade, a spine which is destabilized. So all those things have become very important. I still remember in the pediatric emergency medicine course when we attended along with Pramila at Chennai, that was the first time we were introduced to this idea of how to care about a child after a significant trauma. Because we all teach parts for a long time, but in that trauma is not being taken care of. So I think this module should go to every pediatrician in our state. And hats off to Jayaraman sir and Vishnu for envisaging it, and Pramila and team for taking it forward. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Riyas sir. And now we move on to the academic program. We have three eminent speakers, and Dr. Gladys George, consultant pediatrician, District Model Hospital, Perukada, as the moderator. Now I hand over the mic to Gladys madam for the further proceedings.
So I invite for the first session on overview and introduction to the module by Dr. Vishnu Mohan. Over to you, sir.
Respected seniors and my dear friends, first of all, let me thank our dear President Jayaraman sir for giving us an opportunity and including pediatric trauma management as one of the action plans. So many a times in our practice, we are very well trained or aware about the basic resuscitation modalities, may it be a neonate, we are all so empowered on neonatal resuscitation or pediatric resuscitation with frequent pulse training programs. But trauma as such is often ignored because the ATLS protocols are many a times the pediatricians are untrained or we lack awareness on the primary survey and the primary care about trauma into the precise finer details. So I'll be just giving an overview of our module on management of pediatric trauma. Trauma is any physical damage to the body resulting from sudden exposure to forces exceeding tolerance level. Injuries account for about 12% of the total disease burden in Sri Lanka. With improvement in medical care for infectious diseases, trauma has become a significant contributor for childhood mortality and morbidity. Nearly 1.2 million people die and millions more are injured or disabled, mostly in low and middle income countries. One of the biggest burdens on society and economies, the World Report on Road Traffic Injury Prevention 2004 by the WHO and the World Bank showed improvements in road safety management and specific actions have led to dramatic decreases in road traffic deaths and injuries in countries active in road safety. The use of seat belts, helmets, and child restraints, the report showed, has saved millions of lives. Many children who survive trauma develop temporary or permanent disabilities. The thing to note here, we have a road safety management guideline in a country, but none of those include preventive modalities for child trauma. Like, there are no guidelines for using child restraints or using child seats or being a pillion rider on a two-wheeler in India. So the most common age group affected is 6 to 12 years. Injuries are more common in males compared to females. It is estimated up to 1 million children have traumatic injuries every year. Fall from heights are commonest cause of injuries in children. Road traffic accidents are equally significant contributors for pediatric trauma. The above two causes contribute for up to 90% of all childhood injuries. Burns and drowning are other causes of childhood injuries. So, data about the road traffic accidents in India. Total RTA in India, this is in the year 2018, is last available data from our country. Total RTA in India was approximately 50 lakhs, which involved children. In Kerala, it was 40,260. There were 4,259 deaths and 31,687 grievous injuries. That's around 12 deaths per day in our state. Trauma usually happens due to foreseeable circumstances in the house or on the road. If those are identified and avoided, these injuries are preventable to a great extent. So better outcomes are possible. Having an appropriate prevention guideline, importantly, a pillion rider restriction, and making child car seats mandatory as we have made for seat belts. Appropriate awareness and training on pediatric trauma protocol. Understand the importance of preparation before patient arrival. Identify the correct sequence of assessment of injured child. Identify the components of primary survey. Explain the need for immediate resuscitation during primary survey. Recognize children who need to be transferred to another facility. Very importantly, having an appropriate transport system and transport training. So shouldn't car seats be made compulsory? Three-point lap and diagonal seat belts used by adults are not designed for children's varying sizes, weights, and the varying relative proportions of their body. Seat belts may lead to abdominal injuries among children and will not be optimally effective at preventing ejection and injury. Child restraint or car seats protects by restraining their movement away from the vehicle structure, distributing the forces of a crash over the strongest part of the body with minimum damage to the soft tissues, reducing injuries that occur during non-crash events like a sudden stop, a swerving evasive maneuver, or a door opening during vehicle movement. So we designed a trauma care module by IAP Kerala. So this was the basic, the initial module that we planned, which included all these lectures, including structured approach to a child, sanitary survey, airway and ventilation, management of shock, head trauma, burns, and skill stations with all the essential procedures like cervical collar application, manual inline stabilization, the basic airway control, LMA, intubation, and all, and other essential procedures for breathing, circulation, and a few case scenarios being simulated. So this was planned as a half day session, but as we all are aware, because of the pandemic, we were not able to carry out this as a physical module. So And we hope we will be able to do that soon. So with this, I end my introductory talk. Request the chairperson to take over. Thank you.
So that was a very wonderful session, Dr. Vishnu Mohan. And we were shocked to see the magnitude of road traffic accidents here, especially in India. There were 50 lakhs road traffic accidents in 2018. Was a very big number. And that is an eye-opener. Thanks so much, sir. Now, next I invite our Dr. Pramila Joji on the most awaited topic, pediatric trauma, airway and breathing management. Over to you, Pramila, madam.
Thank you very much, Gladi. A very good evening to all of you. And really appreciating Dr. Vishnu and Jayaraman sir and team for taking up this topic, which is a dear and near topic to my heart. This is something which we really needed in our pediatrics, and really hats off to your team for this. Don't worry, post-COVID, we'll take it up. We'll continue this for the next year also. My full support is there. So with that, let me start. My topic today is pediatric trauma, basically the airway and breathing. So like Vishnu said, it's a very challenging situation. Why it is challenging, pediatric trauma? Why we are scared? Why we are afraid? Because many a times it's a difficult airway. It needs rapid action. And many a times maxillofacial injury and disrupted anatomy. So any failure or any delay, it lead on to high morbidity and mortality. You saw the numbers, which the statistics which Vishnu had shown. It's very, very high. So that's why it's challenging, and we as pediatricians, we have there's a need for each one of us to know more about trauma and train our colleagues too. So today, just a little bit about the history of trauma care, the mechanism of injury, which already Vishnu has said, and basically I'll next 15-20 minutes, I have to stop. So I'll be concentrating more on the airway and breathing. So the objective is already, he has said, Dr. Vishnu has said, so preparation, assessment of injured child, the primary survey, the immediate resuscitation, which we do. And if our facility is not adequate, then once the resuscitation is done, we have to transfer to another facility. So when you ask about the history, like Ria said, we all learned when we went to Chennai and learned the pediatric emergency medicine. Similarly, in 1976, this gentleman, the orthopedic surgeon, James Striner, he was traveling with his family, his wife, three kids in a jet. And you know, the jet crashed in the Nebraska cornfield. And he lost his wife. Since being an orthopedic surgeon, he helped his three kids somehow, the initial management he did, and he took them to a nearby hospital. Once he reached the hospital, he found out that none of the doctors or nurses knew anything about resuscitation or thing. So he got upset, and that started the development of advanced trauma life support. So he is sort of the person who started ATLS, and now all of us are trained in that. And especially the adult side, they're all trained in that. That's why the trauma survival is better in our system now. And the world's first trauma center, it's in Birmingham Accident Hospital in England in 1941, way before the ATLS. So the mechanisms of injury in pediatrics, you should concentrate on two, which is common. One is falls. Falls can be a straight fall, then fall from height. The velocity of fall is very important. And next is a road traffic accident. So it can be different pattern of accidents, but these two mechanisms of injury. So you should have an idea what is happening when you get a child. Why are we worried? Why is the death? Why so many deaths in trauma? It is basically because of the airway issue. Mostly because failure to recognize the need of an airway intervention, the need of an alternate airway. So we think like we can intubate or bag, but no, you have to think about alternate airways also. Then sometimes failure to recognize the need for ventilation. If you recognize the need for ventilation, inability to establish an airway, this is a major issue where death occurs. Then during transport, the displacement of the tube in a trauma child and aspiration. So if you look at the causes of death, these are the most important causes of death. So all the more important that we have to go through this module. So this is the structured approach that Dr. Vishnu and team has made for us to know. And world over, the ATLS trains you in such a way. We are very familiar with the primary as initial impression, primary assessment, the secondary assessment and diagnostic approach for PALS. So ATLS gives a slightly different approach. So you have your primary survey. So what do you mean by primary survey? The immediate, that is your, you have to identify the immediate life threats. What are the immediate life threats? And you start your resuscitation simultaneously. That is your primary survey. Once you do that, then you go for a secondary survey where you will pick up more and more injuries. That is a focused examination, a head-to-toe examination, and you give that emergency care. And the last is ongoing reassessment. So what you do here, you continue your stabilization and you decide your definitive care. all this happens very fast, and in your ED, this has to happen very fast, then only you can save the child. And our aim is to get a neurologically intact child. Fine. So why are you worried about pediatric airway? We all know this, okay? Pediatric airway is slightly different with a narrow funnel shape to this thing, narrow oropharynx, large tongue. That is why the airway management is a worrisome even for the senior-most anesthetist, because large tongue and, you know, floppy epiglottis, larynx is anterior encephalon, very difficult code view, especially in case of severe trauma, collision, face collisions, especially maxillofacial trauma, the face is completely distorted. It's very difficult to get in an airway. So few points I want all of us to know why there is death during the resuscitation. Because, you know, laryngoscopy causes increased vagal response in children compared to adults. So bradycardia happens during intubation. Larger tongue, always there is airway obstruction. Larger adenoid tissues, it can cause difficulty. Usually you don't go for an esophageal airway, but in certain cases where the facial anatomy is distorted, you have to resort to that. Prominent occiput, even when you position the prominent occiput in children, the spine board has to be, should have that depression for containing the occiput. Many times the adult, they cover it with a pad. So you have to remove the pad before placing the child on that, because the prominent occiput you should think of. Then as I told, the floppy epiglottis. So all these are a lot of things which make a pediatric airway much more riskier, much more difficult. So all the more care we have to give. Now, so you get, I'm in my emergency room, I get an alert, okay, that there's a patient coming to me. So what are things as a team leader that I should think? So the nice mnemonic is given by the team. It is admister, the age and sex, okay. So this, at least this much history you should need. The age, what was the time of injury? What is the mechanism of injury? The fall, you should know, say fall from height or a fracture or a runover injury. For example, if you have a right hand fracture and a left foot fracture with a runover, definitely you should think of something. It's a cross fracture. So the abdomen looks okay, but later you will recognize there is some rupture of spleen or something. So all these things, the mechanism of injury is very, very important. What are the injuries you suspect? What are the signs and symptoms, the vital signs, as well as the GCS? The first responder, the first hospital where the patient comes, all these things has to be recorded. What are the treatment you gave? What did you give so far? What did you do? What is the expected time? So I'm sending a patient from here. So somebody has called me and said, I'm sending you a patient. So what is the expected time of arrival? So what are the preparations I have to do? The requirements, and never forget the blood products. So this admister is a very good mnemonic, which will make us remember all this. Okay, it's a great mnemonic, Vishnu. Now, so once you got the call and you're ready, you should have a cord trauma of many of the centers. Ours is a pediatric and adult trauma center. So at KIMS, we have a cord, this is apart from the cord blue, we have a cord trauma. Many of the hospitals have this. We call pediatric trauma cord ED, pediatric trauma cord ED 3 times. So then you have the entire team. Our team consists of a pediatric ICU and emergency consultant. You can see the picture. This is how we position ourselves also. The team leader will be either the pediatric consultant or the ED consultant. Then you have a pediatric surgeon daytime, and the night you get a general surgeon. You have orthopedic surgeon. We have pediatric orthopedic surgeon, anesthetist, as well as the emergency physician and the radiographer. Radiographer is an important part of the team. I always insist when a cord trauma is, the radiographer is immediately there with the, so once the resuscitation is done, immediately the x-rays, whatever we require is taken. So this is how it happens in a tertiary care center. This is the team. It is very important. Once the cord trauma called, all these people rush in 5 minutes and they are there and they know what is. So this needs requited training. So this is what our IAP is aiming at, training us to accumulate, and then all of us just take our position and start so that the resuscitation is excellent. Now, going to primary survey, these are the A, B, C, D, E of primary survey. The airway, see, we usually know airway, breathing, circulation, disability, exposure. So a little more we add in ATLS, airway with protection of spinal cord, breathing with inline ventilation, circulation with hemorrhage control, disability with prevention of secondary insult, and exposure, so control of temperature. So just remember these 5 steps. This is what we have to do immediately. So any peripheral centers also, anywhere, when you get a trauma child, these are your initial. See, initially what you have to do is your primary survey. So I'll be concentrating more on airway and breathing today. So what is the purpose of primary survey? I already told you. Life-threatening emergencies you have to be picked up fast. Life-saving measures that we started. So treat what kills first. So I told, so here the priority, if it is completely unconscious, no pulse, nothing, yes, you know, CPR you have to start. Otherwise it is the airway, airway, airway. That's why A, B, C, so airway is first. So how will you assess the airway? Okay, so why first in the algorithm? Because loss of airway can result in death in less than 3 minutes. So we all know that. So if the airway is not cleared immediately, on spot death happens. If prolonged hypoxia, what happens? Inadequate perfusion and finally endorgan damage. All the damage will happen. So that's why airway with protection of spinal cord has the first option here. So always assume any patient who has a fall, who had a fall, or who is thrown out of the car or a collision, whatever. So think of a cervical spine injury. So that is the dictum. So restrict your cervical spine motion until the spine injury is cleared. Spine injury cleared means if you are thinking of a polytrauma, then you get a CT. Until your orthopedician or your spine surgeon clears of the spine injury, you should not remove the cervical collar. So first you manually stabilize. This should be followed by application of the cervical collar. I think this is very clear. So airway with cervical spine, never forget this. Now, C-spine immobilization, how can you do? So in a peripheral centers where you are not familiar with the collar application or you don't have that, fine. Keep sandbags. Definitely you will get kids with trauma. So sandbags, 1 or 2 kg sandbags, different sandbags you can keep, which you can use. Soft collars, blocks, tapes, side rolls, bed sheet side roll is the minimum you can use. Otherwise, you go for a manual inline stabilization and correct size collar application. You can see in this picture. So the cervical collar being applied. Like Vishnu said, you need a practical approach to this. You have to do it. If you look at the picture, you know it. But unless you do it, it's not easy to put this collar, especially when you have a completely distorted face and a child in front of you gasping. So this needs repeated training. So hopefully once the corona is over, we'll all train you. So how do I know if the airway is adequate? A child is in front of me. The child is alert and oriented. Child is talking and crying normally. No evidence of injury on head and neck. I have reassessed and there's no deterioration. I'm happy. I know the airway is adequate. Okay, so my primary survey, I'm happy. The airway part is okay. But airway compromise, how will I pick up? So high index of suspicion is the most important thing. You should know the mechanism of injury. You should know what happened and you should anticipate. In adult trauma, we say, in ATLS training, we say the three Bs, where you just straight away anticipate reintubation. The three Bs is, one is bullet injury, next is any bite, because you don't know cobra bite or anything, you should not wait. So bullet, bite, and the third one is burns. Severe burns, the inhalation injury, you will not know. So initially, you will find only the body burns, and then the inhalation already caused the vocal cord edema. So these are the three Bs where straight away you go for intubation. Otherwise, you should have a high index of suspicion. Watch for noisy breathing, hoarse voice. That means there is some problem in the larynx and definitely the child is going to deteriorate. Dyspnea, agitation. Severe agitation, that should point you towards hypoxia. Or obtended means mostly it will be hypercarbia. So retractions, abnormal breathing. Always look for abnormal breathing pattern. So saturation, if you look at it initially, will be whatever you observe, please remove. Look for fractures in the lower face and any injuries of the neck, because again, this is going to compromise my airway. So any of this is there, I know I'm going to have a tough time. Okay. The most common problem in pediatrics during airway management is occlusion. I told you the problem in pediatrics during airway management is occlusion. I told you it's a large tongue, occlusion by the tongue in an unconscious head injured child. So once the compromise, you think, what next? How do I manage this airway? So supplemental oxygen, the basic techniques, what I do, and the basic adjuncts. So like independent of the need determined by saturation monitoring, many a times you need high flow oxygen, 10 to 50 liters by reservoir mask. But inadequate spontaneous ventilation, definitely we all know, we have been trained in BLS, we go for Magen mask. Then rapidly you have screened for all the life threats, such as tension pneumothorax or whatever. So the breathing and high flow oxygen is very important. Now, what are the basic techniques? As I told you initially, the head in neutral position, suppose you have to have a jaw thrust. Jaw thrust, however hard I try to explain, unless you do it once, it is difficult. So these are the basic techniques we do in trauma. What are the basic adjuvants? Yes, the oropharyngeal airway, it's very important. An unconscious child, you have to put in an OPA, NPA and NG tube, nasopharyngeal airway. This side, you can see the NPA. Nasopharyngeal airway as well as NG tube, you should be very careful. Ideally, you should not use, because especially when there is a base of the skull trauma or any maxillofacial injury, you shouldn't use it. Oropharyngeal airway, yes, that will help you in pulling down the, you can remove that obstruction by the tongue by using this. So these are the basic adjuvants, fine. Now, what is the sequence of airway management? You are stuck with a child, so jaw thrust, avoid head tilt. So head tilt, chin lift is not used, you have to use the jaw thrust manual. Suction the sacrum, use a younger suction, a suction with a bigger bore, because sometimes the child will be vomiting, vomitus, everything will be there. You have to remove that. Remove the foreign body, everything should be done under direct vision. Okay. So here you can see the occiput causing. Here the plane of face is not in line to the spine board. So here, then you have put a spine board here onto this thing. Now you know occiput is like this. Some of the spine board have a depression for that occiput. Make sure if any pad over that, just remove that, then it is much easier. So the plane of the face of a child should be parallel to the spine board. Now, this is your manual inline stabilization. You have to stabilize properly. How you hold is, you can see in the picture, plus oropharyngeal airway, I already told you. So you do all this, and finally, in trauma, you go as early as possible for go for the definitive airway, because securing an airway is the utmost important thing in a trauma. Okay, so I'll tell the importance of that towards the end of this. So tracheal intubation with manual, it's called as MILS, manual inline stabilization of the spine. And that is done fine. If you feel, so you are always in for surprises. Being part of the trauma management in my hospital, I know many times we are in for surprise, and a few times we have to go in for surgical airway. Surgical airway in pediatrics in children is very, very difficult. It is almost equivalent to death. Now, how do I predict a potentially difficult airway? Okay, fine. I told bagging. See, stabilization means not just bagging or just putting in the tube. It is not easy. It depends on the team. It depends on the leader, the team leader, how he anticipates and predicts what is going to happen. So a foresight, you know, a hindsight, an insight, and a foresight is very much required when you manage trauma. So I am bagging, I am finding very difficult to bag. This is the mnemonic which is used in the adult emergency, same we can incorporate into peds also. So the when I'm bagging, if I'm finding it difficult, the mass seal, okay, check. If there is severe obstruction, I'll find it difficult. Okay, in elderly, fine, I'm just leaving that. That's taken from the adult side. The no teeth, it's difficult. Stiffness, resistance, you're bagging. All this, see, I know I'm going to have a difficult time with the airway. Fine. Now, I'm going to intubate. So what? How will I assess the intubation? Is it going to be a difficult intubation? Yes, you have again the Lemon approach. It is L-E-M-O-N. It's a mnemonic. L, look externally for facial trauma. If you are seeing a facial trauma, nasal bone fracture, some maxillofacial injury with full bleed, you should anticipate it's going to be a very difficult airway for you. Then there's a 3-3-3 rule for older children as well as adults we do. Then the Malampati airway assessment, O for obstruction, and N for neck mobility. But this neck mobility, when you are suspecting a C-spine, the neck mobility usually we don't do. And unresponsive children, that Malampati is difficult. So it is L-E-O-N. I think I'm clear there. So this is the 3-3 rule. If you look at that, see the three finger, this thing from the incisor, the inter-incisor gap. If I find that it is less than that, I know access to airway and obtaining a glottic view is going to be tough for me. The next one is next three, the hypomental, tip of the mentum to hyoid bone. Again, that three tip is not there. That means once I put in the scope, the tongue cannot be deflected. Once I put the laryngoscope, the tongue cannot be deflected. It's very difficult. It's going to be again a difficult airway. Then the thyromental distance. Okay, that is from the tip here to the floor of the. So all this 3-3-3 rule, if it is damaged, I know I'm again going to have a difficult intubation. Fine. Then the Malampati score. So in a moderate type of this thing, especially in head injury, we cannot do this. Otherwise, this is the airway score. When the score is more than the three, class three or class four, as you can see, then you know it is going to be again a difficult intubation. So this is ear muff Mills, which is well practiced in adult emergency. Adult emergencies are doing this. It is exactly like this is the your online, see your manual inline stabilization, and you hold. The person who holds on the side, just like your ear muff. Okay, just like you put the ear muff. It will be almost like that. You have to hold it completely with the occiput on the side of the jaw, and you should not move the head at all. And the intubator will definitely do his job. Definitive airway, it is oral intubation and burp and suction BAP. What is burp? It is the laryngeal manipulation which you do sometimes, which is required to help your team in intubation. A backward, upward, rightward pressure. Okay, this will help in visualization. So how will you, definitive airway is intubation, we know, but is it easy to intubate a child? It's not easy to intubate a child when there's a distorted face or severe polytrauma. So there's a pre-intubation checklist. I really ask all the pediatricians to have their own pre-intubation checklist. Of this, the most important is the briefing. See, what is your role? And RSI, if the RSI fails, what next? What is your plan A? Plan A, you go by the RSI, rapid sequence intubation. Plan B, what is it? Plan C, what is it? Keep all the airway adjuncts, which will help you in managing a traumatic airway. So what are the intubation pearls? Intubation and ventilation is paramount to prevent secondary injury. What are the concerns? Already I told you, the cervical spine stabilization is at most important, difficult airway, and most important, intubation is a very noxious procedure. So ICP and secondary injury, please take care of that. the rapid sequence intubation, I'm not going into details of that because of a lack of time. So what is the advantage of using this? Because, you know, it optimizes the intubation condition. The rate of successful intubation is more if you do decrease the time for intubation, decrease the risk of aspiration and attenuation of hemodynamic and ICP changes. So go for RSI. RSI steps is beyond the scope of this talk, but you should know the steps of RSI and what are the drugs you're using, especially the post-intubation management. Each hospital department has their own policy. You know what is the induction paralysis agent you are comfortable with, what you are comfortable, what your department protocol, please go by that. Suppose, okay, I go for intubation and I find it difficult. My definitive airway is going to be difficult. I have assessed by the Lemon mnemonic. I know it's going to be difficult. So what should I do? I should have all these accessories. The gum elastic boogie assisted intubation, yes. You have to have a pediatric boogie and this will help you. You should have your LMA. You can have a classic LMA. This all we teach you in the pediatric advanced life support. You have the classic LMA as well as the LMA ProSeal, which is much more a second generation LMA, where the gastric approach is also there. You can have a peace of mind because, you know, the gastric regurgitation doesn't happen. Combi tube is there. I not used in this in pediatrics, but adult side, they use this. This is a double tube, it's esophageal. You can see the two bulbs there. It is esophageal and tracheal. These are all very easy to use. Your LMA as well as this, very easy to use and buying time till you prepare for your this thing. But in case of trauma, but when it comes to trauma, it is in the direct laryngoscopy and intubation as early as possible. Those are the adjuncts if you fail. There are some situations where cannot intubate, cannot ventilate, cannot oxygenate. When you are faced in such a situation, it is really tough. You are lost. You are not able to get an airway. Then what? So video laryngoscopy, now most of us are trained in this. We can see our skill lab, our adult emergency physician, as well as the pediatric intensive is getting trained by the HOD anesthesia in video laryngoscopy. You keep on retraining and your skills will improve. Now, so this is the last part, the surgical airway, FONA, friend of neck airway. So if I remember in my last 18 years experience, twice we have done that. And those two babies we lost because that is the last thing, nothing we could do. It was complete difficult airway and needle cricothyrotomy and tracheostomy tried, but you know, that much time we won't get. So needle cricothyrotomy is a surgical airway which you can use. Your surgical cricothyrotomy is not indicated in children, it is done in adults. So you can have percutaneous as well as surgical. For adult, you have a lot of things, but for child, nothing is there. That is why we say anticipate. Anticipate, prepare, anticipate, start your initial management fast, get an airway as early as possible. Like if you lose that time, then you know, like it is very difficult, then you have to go for your needle trichothyrotomy. Now, I have intubated now, I have secured airway, then what? Now the ventilatory support. So inspect the tracheal position, jugular veil distension, chest wall asymmetry, bruises, open chest wounds. Always look for this. Completely you expose the child and then you have to look for that. Because many a time you can see flail chest, hemothorax, pneumothorax and all those things. Respiratory rate and retractions has to be turned. Palpate and percus, okay, fine. Crepitus resonance. Always you have to, you can see the surgical emphysema. So many a times you miss all this unless you examine. If you don't undress fully, you'll be missing a big fracture thigh or some bleed or hematoma which has happened. You do everything in the resuscitation, but you cannot do anything. My colleague Vivin will be talking on the circulatory part. Now, auscultate for air entry. So in the ED, you do all this, get the child ready. And now, see, the child is all yours to take care. Now you just look at any complications, specific complications and manage the complications. If you have tension pneumothorax, definitely the decompression. And you know what to do. You have to put in a needle and confirm that, and then followed by ICD. So that clears the breathing and ventilation. Fine. So this is important part which I want to let you know. The children with multi-system trauma, polytrauma, should be cared in a trauma center. You start your care in the peripheral center where you get the child. You assess the child. Do not delay transfer to perform. See, you should not waste time in doing investigations. You try to stabilize. That's why we taught you the assessment, the stabilization. Once you stabilize, this is a very good score, pediatric trauma score. Please download it and then put in your emergency. If the trauma score is less than 4, that means this child is very bad. This child needs referral. So need to transfer is there. So just to summarize what I told you today, if a child with trauma comes to you, a polytrauma, a facial trauma, a fall from height, any trauma come to you, normal airway, yes, you proceed, but always think of difficult airway. Not normal airway, but facilities and expertise are available. Yes, you can proceed. You go ahead and manage. But if facilities and expertise are not available, fine. but it is an emergency, because if you don't do anything, you have no time to transfer child to another center. Yes, go ahead and perform whatever. But you know, if a life or limb saving, definitely go ahead. But you have time. You have time and you can do, then stop. Refer to a specialized center. Because a lot of studies are there which have proven that. So if you manipulate, unless you don't, if you don't know, you can just call in ambulances, which are transport ambulances with the experts, come to your site and do the things. Please go ahead with that. It's very important. You have to know when to refer to a specialized center, because every child's life is very important. This is my last slide. This is my team of emergency, pediatric emergency, adult emergency, as well as the intensive care team training, getting trained in our simulation lab. And this is Amal, who came to us almost crushed, I should say, multiple fractures, pelvic fractures, long bone fractures, hematoma in the brain, so all bleed everywhere. But thanks to the Gogula Medical College emergency physician who intubated the child, the airway was secured in Gogula Medical College beautifully. It was a very bad child. And then they called us, they transferred in all good condition within less than, I should say, in half an hour, the child reached us. And then we could continue. This is a child for him. For him, we had to do a massive transfusion protocol in the ED. We had to. It was a very difficult because there's no place to get a line also. With one peripheral line and a central line put in ED, we could manage him. And today he came for review. And with his parents' permission, I told, like, today I'm going to present polytrauma. This is an excellent example for the teamwork. The primary care, where the child first went. The child first went to Gokulam and the ED physician took care of the airway. So that's the importance of airway. Child had a lot of problems, multiple surgeries. He had to undergo neurosurgery. He had to undergo orthopedic surgery, pediatric surgery. But all this could happen because the initial care was done beautifully by the ED physician. So that shows it. That's it from my side. This is our skills lab where our team gets trained and retrained. Thank you very much for the opportunity to share our experiences as well as teach you about trauma, pediatric trauma. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pramila. That was a very wonderful talk on a very dreadful topic. And every sentence was a piece of information for us. And thanks so much. Thanks so much for this very useful topic. And our next session is on shock and head injury. I invite Dr. Vibin Abraham for the topic. Over to you, sir.
Thank you for the kind words. Just wait a minute. At the onset, I would like, good evening, everybody. At the onset, I'd like to thank Jayaraman sir, Dr. Johnny, and IAP Trivandrum for giving me the opportunity. I'd like to go to the topic. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are audible.
Okay. So,
slides are not visible.
It's visible now?
No. You haven't shared the PPT, you have shared the computer screen instead.
One minute.
I think you can stop share the screen and restart sharing the PPT.
Okay. Is it visible now?
Yeah, coming. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Sorry for the delay. I'd like to come to the topic. I'll start with circulation and hemorrhage control. So main objectives is to recognize a child who is in shock with trauma, to understand the importance of rapidly controlling the source of hemorrhage, initial management of the shock and basic principles of balanced resuscitation. So, as you know, when you compare children with adults, the blood volume varies. So in an infant, the blood volume is around 85 ml per kg. In a child aged 1 to 3 years is around 80 ml per kg. And child more than 3 years, around 75 ml per kg. Whereas when you look at adults, they have a blood volume around 75 ml per kg. So children have a greater cardiac reserve and compensate well initially with tachycardia, and hypotension is a very late sign. Causes of shock. Hemorrhage is supposed to be the most common cause of shock. The cause of hemorrhage can be either external or internal. So external is mainly due to the open wounds, and internal or concealed, the most common sites are either the chest, abdomen, pelvis, femur, retroperitoneum, or the scalp. So coming to the causes, it can be either obstructive. 1 minute. Sorry, obstructive, it can be tension pneumothorax or pericardial effusion. Cardiogenic will be myocardial stunning, or neurogenic is because of spinal cord injury. So how do you approach a case of shock? We have four parameters. Either the one is recognition of shock and its severity, the initial treatment, assess the response, and definitive bleeding control. So to recognize shock and its severity, tachycardia is the earliest and the most sensitive sign. The signs of poor perfusion which you need to keep in mind is the cold peripheries, prolonged CFT, narrow pulse pressure. Hypotension is not needed to diagnose shock. Hypotension is indicative of a severe hemorrhage, which means there is more than 40% of blood volume loss. The other thing which you find is lactic acidosis and base deficit, and usually the hematocrit is normal. So one should remember that the initial signs of shock are either tachycardia and signs of poor perfusion. Tachycardia can also be because of the pain, or it can be anxiety or other causes, but you need to look into it. And one must remember that shock can be missed if only one single parameter like BP is used. Coming to the classification, in adults it is a classification of class 1, 2, 3, and 4, but in children it's classified into mild, moderate, and severe. In mild cases, approximate blood volume is less than 30%. The circulation, you will have tachycardia, feeble peripheral pulses. The child will usually be irritable. In moderate shock, then the child will be in marked tachycardia, weak central pulses, narrow pulse pressure. The child is usually lethargic, and the blood volume is estimated to be around 30 to 45%. And in severe shock, the child is hypotensive and bradycardic. The child is usually obtunded, and approximate blood loss is more than 45%. So you look for signs of uncontrolled bleeding or non-hemorrhagic causes for bleeding. So coming to the initial treatment, the most important step is definitive control of bleeding. Either it can be surgical or interventional. So to ensure adequate oxygenation and ventilation, identify and control exsanguination hemorrhage. Replace the intravascular volume with crystalloids or blood. Repeatedly reassess perfusion and tissue oxygenation, and consider an early surgical consultation. Coming to fluid management, it is always better to put two large bore intravenous cannulae. Care should be taken to not put a cannula into an injured limb. If the injury is below the diaphragm, at least one peripheral venous cannula should be in the arm or in the neck. If you have two failed unsuccessful attempts, then an intraosseous needle access is preferable. Draw bloods for type, cross-matching, hemogram, and blood gas, and immediately administer 20 ml per kg of isotonic crystalloid RL or NS over 5 to 20 minutes. Controlling the bleeding. External bleedings can be controlled by either direct pressure, wound packing, splints, or tourniquet. If the shock is persistent in the absence of external bleed, then consider internal hemorrhage. So in case of internal, so if you suspect a case of internal hemorrhage, then immediate surgical consultation is needed. Pelvis is supposed to be one of the most common causes of internal bleeds. So you can apply a pelvic binder. The pelvic binder can help in control the bleeding in the pelvis, and when to apply when a child is hemodynamically unstable or when you have suspected abnormal fever or pelvic injury. So putting it when you look at the anatomical landmarks, you have to look at the greater trochanteric anterior superior iliac spine. So you have a specific pelvic binder which you can bind the pelvis so that there is immobility is maintained. Or if the binder is not available, then you can use a bed sheet wherein you can see in the diagram below that you have and cover the patient and then twist the sheets ends and then make a 180-degree turn and then maybe you can clamp and make it stabilized. Coming to assessing the response, you have three types of response. Either it's a rapid responders, the transient responders, or non-responders. Rapid responders are children who are stabilized with only crystalloid fluids and blood is usually not required, but there are a subset of children who need blood for stabilization. Transient responders are one who have an initial improvement, but then after that there is deterioration occurring. And non-responders are children who do not respond to either crystalloids or blood transfusion. And one have to remember that in case of non-responders and transient responders, urgent surgical consultation is needed to find out the cause of bleeding. And when you, what do you look for signs of improvement? Either when the tachycardia improves, the peripheral perfusion improves, the BP is better, the urine output improves, and the acidosis is showing an improving trend. So what is balanced resuscitation? So one must remember that you should avoid using large volumes of crystalloids. A balanced ratio of packed cells, FFP, and platelets is needed. If a child is weighing more than 30 kg, then you give PRBC, FFP, and platelets in the ratio 1:1:1. If the child is less than 30 kg, then the ratio has to be 30 ml/20 ml/20 ml/kg respectively. If cryoprecipitate is needed, if bleeding is persistent, but or after one set of blood products, if fibrinogen is less than 150 also, you could give cryo. Thromboelastogram can help in assessing the need for specific products. Coming to the lethal triad, the first thing is coagulopathy where there is bleeding, then which leads to lactic acidosis and also acidosis in the blood, which in turn leads to myocardial dysfunction and lead to hypothermia, and there is decreased coagulation. So the lethal triad is the one which we need to keep in mind because it can be very lethal. What are the adjuvants what you can use to blood transfusion? One can be low ratio PRBC to products. The other thing is limiting the amount of crystalloids which you use. Tranexamic acid can be used at the dose of 15 mg/kg and then 2 mg/kg/hour. Correct hypocalcemia, hypothermia is one problem which you rapidly encounter. So we could use a warm environment and also use fluids and blood warmers. Acidosis is mainly because of the shock. So you could use fluid resuscitation and massive transport protocol to correct the acidosis. Bicarbonate only if there is severe acidosis and the pH is less than 7.1 because it can lead to myocardial dysfunction. So the most important step is definitive control of bleeding, either surgical or interventional. So coming to internal bleeds, the focus of bleeding is because of the mechanism of injury, the external bruise over chest, abdomen, or perineum. You have to look at the x-rays of pelvis and femur. E-FAST is the ultrasound FAST scan or the E-FAST and CT chest and abdomen. So what is FAST? FAST is focused assessment with sonology in trauma. So it uses an ultrasound probe to look at four areas, the right upper quadrant, the left upper quadrant, the subxiphoid, and the suprapubic. So it takes only a few minutes to look at whether there is hemorrhage or not. So there is also another entity called E-FAST, which looks at the peritoneum, pleura, and pericardial cavity. So a positive FAST study can help locate the internal bleeding in a child with shock. A negative FAST does not rule out bleeds. So you have a look, here you have the right upper quadrant wherein you look at the liver, where there is any contusion of the liver or the laceration of liver. You look at the left upper quadrant where there is laceration of spleen or bleeds. Then the subxiphoid when you look at the myocardium and also the suprapubic region where you look at for ascites or ascites. So bleeding control, the CT imaging of chest and abdomen to find out the exact cause of bleed needed to transport or not recommended for, and it's not recommended for unstable children. In a stable child, CT can be done to localize the area of bleed. An urgent laparotomy is indicated if a child is unstable, with clinically suspected abdominal bleed, or FAST scan is positive, or no other source of bleeding. So, if the child is presenting with tachycardia, poor pulses, or hypotension, then you start off with airway breathing as saturation has already, breathing and circulation has already, madam has already told you. So start off oxygen, start off with a bolus of normal saline or 20 ml per kg, and then use warm fluids. So at first you may not be getting warm fluids, but preferably it is better to use warm fluids if it's possible, practically possible. Avoid high BPs, and also after the initial bolus, you reassess the child. Look at the perfusion, whether the perfusion has improved or not, whether the peripheral pulses are better felt or not. Look at the BP, whether there is urine output, whether the child is conscious or not. If the shock is corrected, then you continue with the maintenance. Or if the shock is not corrected and persistent, then you look at the FAST scan. So you look at whether there is any laceration of the liver, laceration of spleen, or any trauma to the abdomen where there is any ascites, or look at the pericardium. You would always, it would be nice if you could arrange for O negative blood, because you could think potentially at a surgical cause. So you have to, ultimately you need to control the bleeding with damage control surgery. Causes of non-hemorrhagic shock: when the shock is persistent in spite of crystalloids and blood products, then you look at other causes. And you should always remember that if there is a discrepancy between the volume replacement and what has been estimated, then you need to look at other causes. The causes might be either obstructive when there is tension pneumothorax or cardiac tamponade, or cardiogenic if there is myocardial stunning, or neurogenic if there is spinal cord injury. So what are the take-home points? You have to remember that tachycardia with decreased perfusion indicates shock even in the absence of hypotension. Control of external or internal bleeds is important step in correcting shock, and used balanced resuscitation with blood products as a bridge to definitive bleeding control. Coming to traumatic brain injury, the objectives are to learn the components of focused neurological examination, understand TBI and its pathophysiology, and understand the principles of prevention of secondary brain injury. So, as Riya sir has already mentioned, head injury is one of the most common causes of trauma in children aged 1 to 15 years. And usually the trauma is because of road traffic accidents or falls. It's mostly 80% of them are because of that. In infants, child abuse needs to be considered. And patients with apparently severe TBI can realize significant neurological recovery with appropriate and aggressive early care. So, primary traumatic brain injury is a damage which occurs as a result of direct impact due to trauma. And secondary brain injury is because of, it represents the additional damage due to secondary insults. Aim is of head injury management is to prevent or minimize secondary brain injury. Coming to secondary brain injury, it can be because of ischemia, hypoxia, fever, convulsions, or maybe hypoglycemia or hyperglycemia. So, the one has to remember the Montreux-Kelly doctrine, wherein you have to remember that the total volume in intracranial contents remains the same. So we all know that the cerebral perfusion pressure is equal to mean arterial pressure minus intracranial pressure. So in the first diagram, you see an equilibrium between the brain, CSF, and the blood. When you have a bleed or a mass effect, then slowly there is pressure on the CSF and the blood. And when the mass effect increases, then there is a rise in intracranial pressure. So one has to remember that after a limit, there is a quick rise in ICP. So cerebral blood flow decreases. If there is a decrease in cerebral blood flow, and if it's not corrected immediately, then ischemic changes start to set in. So one has to remember that the mean arterial pressure has to be kept between 50 to 150 millimeters of mercury to maintain a constant cerebral blood flow. This autoregulatory curve is mostly lost in head injury. So even a small drop in blood pressure from baseline can significantly reduce cerebral blood flow and result in ischemia. Similarly, one has to remember that the high CO2 can also lead to cerebral edema. Coming to management, treatment is focused on reducing the ICP. So one would be surgical evacuation of hematoma if it is there, or medical by reducing cerebral edema and maintaining cerebral perfusion pressure. the important thing you need to remember is prevention of secondary brain injury. So coming to disability, focused neurological evaluation, you look at the GCS, pupillary reflex, and obvious neurological deficit. We all know GCS score, if it's mild traumatic brain injury, if it is GCS is 13 to 15, moderate if 9 to 12, and severe if 3 to 8. Severe TBI should be managed, should receive aggressive support without delay. So priorities are to assess the child early and manage the airway, breathing, and circulation, appropriate neurosurgical involvement, and prevention of secondary brain injury, especially hypoxia and hypotension. Coming to airway, you have to airway should be maintained with optimum oxygenation and ventilation. If needed, intubation, I think madam has already explained all those, so I'll skip the slide. And hypotension should be aggressively treated as its cause should be identified and corrected. Indications for immediate intubation, madam has already covered. And we need to, what should you do in an ICU? The head has to be kept in, head and should be elevated to 15 to 30 degree. Keep the head in midline. Maintain a systolic BP of more than 95th centile for age. Correct hypotension urgently with fluids, blood products, and inotropes. Maintain a saturation of more than 94%. And do a blood gas to target a CO2 of 35 to 40 millimeters of mercury. And importantly, avoid hyperventilation. Coming to medical management, administer anticonvulsants, phenytoin or levetiracetam can be preferred. It can, there are some studies which say that it can cause a decrease in the early post-traumatic seizures. Adequate seizure control of seizures should be done very aggressively. Maintain normothermia, treat hyperthermia aggressively, adequate sedation and analgesia, and maintain normal blood sugars. If a child is already intubated, any stimulus is a painful process. So you could give lignocaine 1 mg per kg around 15 to 20 minutes prior to any procedure, either it's suction or putting a cannula or any other procedure, so that you can minimize the intracranial pressure. Coming to a choice between 3% saline and mannitol, hyperosmolar therapy, usually you give either 3% saline, it lowers the ICP. The initial bolus is 3 to 5 ml per kg, followed by 0.5 to 1 ml per kg per hour infusion. You can target a serum sodium of around 145 to 150. Mannitol can be used at the rate of 0.25 to 1 gram per kg in case of acute deterioration, unequal pupils, or posturing. One must keep in mind that mannitol should not be used in case in a hypotensive patient. Coming to intracranial bleeds, CT scan should be done for any child who is presenting with intracranial severe TBI. So you can see this diagram which shows a subdural hematoma, and on the right is a epidural hematoma. So how do you differentiate? Subdural hematoma is by the shape, it is a crescentric shape one, and it's usually due to bridging rupture of the bridging veins. Whereas epidural is due to a convex lens shaped hemorrhage, and it is due to a rupture of middle meningeal artery. If you suspect, if there is a child who is presenting with subdural hematoma, consider a shaken baby syndrome also. There may be other types of injuries like diffuse injuries, concussion, hypoxic, ischemic, diffuse axonal injury, and focal leg epidural subdural hematomas, contusions, or intracerebral hematomas. Immediate neurosurgical consultation must be done for all patients with head injury, and surgical intervention should be done immediately if needed. This is a case of cerebral edema because there is ventricles are being chinked and there is no sulcic array differentiation. So coming to the flow chart, if there is a GCS of less than 14, loss of GCS more than 3, or fracture, if there is, if it is yes, then you do a CT. If no, then you see whether the child has a seizure, a loss of consciousness more than 5 seconds, severe mechanism of injury, either severe headache, vomiting, or scalp hematoma in a child less than 2 years. Yes, then you do a CT or observation. Or if these conditions are not there, then CT is not generally recommended. It is preferable to do a CT in children less than 3 months or if there is a parental preference. Take-home points. Airway, breathing, circulation are the key. The aim is to prevent secondary brain injury, hypoxia, and hypotension. CT head for all severe traumatic brain injury should be done. Follow a neuroprotective measures, early neurosurgery consultation and intervention if it is needed, and frequently reassess and transfer to a definitive care center if it is needed. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks so much, sir, for the excellent talk. It was a very useful and very informative session, and touching all the areas of shock and head injury, and which will be very useful to us in our practice. And you have made it very clear cut and precise. Thanks so much, sir. Now, I think we will go to the interactive session, and all the speakers are available, I think, for a small discussion. And in the chat box, I think there are no queries till now.
Madam, there is one question in the webinar chat, that is pre-hospital transport of traumatic child. I think it's to Pramila, madam. Infrastructure requirement, Joyce.
What is the question, Praveen? What can you repeat?
The pre-hospital transport of a traumatic child. No.
Okay, that's a very good question. So pre-hospital transport at the site. So an RTA happened, and from the site, it's always better to call ambulance who can transport 108 or areas where private hospitals where the ambulance service is available. So in and around, you should know where which are the trauma centers you can rely on, and that hospital's ambulance you can call. Okay. And then on site, the team, experienced team will come and transport. That is the most important thing. But if you are trained in basic life support, if you can do something, then it is very important. Always remember the spine. So on site, the pre-hospital, this thing is always to call EMTs. Now most of 108 ambulance also, the EMTs are trained. And most of the hospitals, they send trained personnel. EMTs are available. So that is the most important thing which you have to do, pre-hospital care. The scoop and run technique is now, see, there are a lot of studies telling that rather than stay safe and play is better than scoop and run. Previously, we used to just take someone, put in car and rush to the hospital. By the time we reach hospital, the airway is compromised and the patient dies. So now rather than scoop and run, it is safe and stay and play. That means you have to get a team there and do. If that is not possible, at least with the the best, whatever you can do, you could do. That's what I think. Pre-hospital, definitely it's a major important thing, whether you can transport in a very good condition. Better to call ambulance and put in at least a stretcher, log roll and take the baby there and transport. That is the best. Vishnu, you want to add anything to that? Vivin, Vishnu?
Nothing more to add, man. Yeah.
So that's
it. Infrastructure requirement.
Pre-hospital care means it is not a pre-hospital care is not infrastructure. From the site you are transferring in the hospital, what you need is like at least the basics you need. I told you, in the periphery hospitals where you don't have a cervical collar and a difficult, prepare some sandbags, keep a traumatic child come to you for airway equipments. What you need, the basic airway equipments. Okay, so whatever which is helpful, whatever I told, oropharyngeal airway, then your LMA, and at least whatever, get a cannula. All those things. Getting a cannula and putting the circulation, getting a cannula as well as setting the airway is the most important. If the child is okay, there is a major trauma, but the child is able to talk, converse, then don't disturb the child. Just transport the child to the nearest center available earlier. So I think really this module is very much needed, Vishnu, because once you have a module with a practical training like we do in PALS and BLS, it will be much easier for all of us.
Working on a manual also, madam, will release that soon.
Can I add, madam, there are no sandbags. You could actually think about bed sheets. You can log roll it and then maybe you can stabilize the bed sheets, because most of the centers, you will not have the adequate size of neck collar available. So it can cause more harm than good if you have an inadequate or inappropriate head collar. So bed sheet would, which is easily available in every hospital, would also be useful if in a case of a dire emergency, if you don't have any other things.
Yeah, that's very good. I just got one. So I just got a towel from here and can just show. So fold it like this. And actually it is like this. You put, see this, you have to pull below the neck actually. Pull below the neck and it will be almost like this. Cross like this, you can stretch and keep. So at least that much will be there. Or if you have blocks, wooden blocks or sandbags, you can put on both sides. Sandbags is good. Sandbags, wooden blocks and something like that, and strapping with a cloth bed sheet, at least like Vivin said, is very important. That much at least has to be there. Okay, these are things which you can do. and keep a bag and mask. Everybody should be trained in, nobody should be, I don't mind if nobody is trained in intubation, it's okay. But at least bag and mask and the basic things, it is very important.
Hello? Yes, sir. Gladimel, I think
There are no more questions, and somebody is trying to ask something and that call is gone, I think. So this is a very important topic. I think nobody is daring to speak so much on this. Even I am not much aware of these sort of things. But now we are going in for an era where we should be aware of these things, and litigations are coming that you should do to this to my child, if you have done that, this and that, my child would have saved like that. So we can't escape from these hot cases. We should be more and more aware of these things. And when we start managing these things, we will be able to discuss things. And we should reach that later. And so we won't run away from these sort of topics. We will again and again, we will do these things, especially we have got very good intensivists in pediatrics. We all can again and again study from them. We will start doing all these hot cases confidently. We are all good pediatricians. And in later years, we have to be familiar with all these things, all the pediatricians. And even government is trying to train even lay public to do the basics of resuscitation, the trauma care and all. Even now the common people know what to do with the cervical spine, with the airway and all. So we should be aware of these things. And we will again, I think, we will again and again go into this very important and very dreadful topic again. And for now, I think we will stop the discussion if there is no inputs from anybody else. If anybody wants to talk, please, or we will stop. I invite anybody to have some inputs. So I think we'll stop, Elaine.
Yes, ma'am.
So we'll, thank you. Yes, okay, to you, Praveen.
Thank you, Gladi, madam. It was a very excellent talk. I thank especially Dr. Vishnu and team for developing this module. And today's speakers, Dr. Pramila Joji and Dr. Vivin Abraham and Vishnu. I thank all the speakers on behalf of IAP Trivandrum. And we have Dr. Johnny Sebastian, our IAP secretary, till he stayed till the end of the program. And I thank him. And our IAP Trivandrum president, Sandosh sir, he couldn't join the program due to some other engagements. Dr. Riya sir, then our IAP Kerala president, Dr. T.P. Jayaraman sir, and all the participants who attended through the webinar platform. We had around 146 participants. And I thank all people who attended the program and made it a big success. And I request Vishnu and team to continue this module, continue developing this module to reach all the pediatricians of the state. Not only pediatricians, it should be reached to all the doctors. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Praveen, for the opportunity and hosting today.